I asked my son Ebenezer to record and publish my remarkable experiences in the early Methodist Church. I did not want the history of Methodism to die, of what our ancestors had done. I see that he did get it done because there is a book that he wrote about Elizabeth, the disinherited daughter. Well, I guess I was disinherited, but it wasn't of my own, it was of my own choosing, or should I say, of God's choosing. Is that better? You see, I was the youngest, or eldest, of six children. My father was a wealthy farmer, stock raiser, and skillful horseman. For the late 1700s, I was born in 1778. And I was raised in a John Calvin home, which means that it was kind of strict, and it was the forebears of what we would call today the Presbyterian or Congregational Reformist Church. And we sometimes refer to them as Presbyterians or Congregationalists today. For the late 1700s, I was given a liberal education and became the apple of my father's eye when riding through the fields of our estate near Middletown, Massachusetts, or Connecticut, rather. At 17, I was sent from my home to live with cultured relatives in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, where I was to learn the social graces. And so it was that I went there. And not to be called shiftless, I also took on a job as a teacher. This situation was very agreeable because I lived with some cultured relatives that taught me the graces, but I had some young cousins that would join me on my horseback riding because I loved to ride horseback and I often rode with my father when I was home. And they would join me in the morning and in the afternoon for my rides. And it was on one of these rides that we would pass by a meeting of this thing called new and strange people called Methodists. We often paused in our riding to listen to the sweet and moving singing of these people. Then after a while, we caught on to the tunes and we liked them so much we wanted to learn the words. And so my cousins and I became brave and we tied up our horses and we went inside and sat down, charmed by their songs. We also became curious to hear their prayers and their testimonies and even their occasional shouts. At first, we were there for curiosity, and we were somewhat mocking of them afterwards with our friends. But the Holy Spirit was at work. We were the subjects of mighty prayers and powerful exhortations from these people. And the Spirit was at work in my heart. And after a time, I felt the pull and clearly saw myself as a sinner and on the way to ruin with my frivolous lifestyle with my cousins. In desperation, more than hope, I went alone one day to the Methodist prayer meeting. I made known my convictions and purposes and sought instruction and help. I came away with hope. But I still was not at peace. As much as I called upon the Lord in prayer and confession and persevered in my seeking, I was not satisfied. One day in my room, I saw myself in the mirror, all my finery so profuse in its ornamentation. I realized my fancy apparel and lifestyle was making me very vain and was a hindrance to me. I then went to a plain dress which in black, which I have worn ever since. I smashed all my beautiful, expensive jewelry, and I was able to go to the next prayer meeting a different person. At once I was caught up in the prayers, able to put my hand with the others there and into Jesus' strong and steady grip. The conversion was instantaneous, exceedingly clear and powerful. I had found peace in the midst of a storm. And after time, I wrote a simple, clear letter home about my experience. My family was much troubled. Our Betsy, in league with those religious fanatics, those Methodist lunatics. My letter was taken to our local church and the parish priest. He was able to relieve most of my family's apprehensions, but not my father. He called me home in order to deprogram me. However, my Methodist meetings meant too much to me. I developed the habit of slipping out of our family Calvinist church service in Middletown and attending the Methodist meetings down the street and around the corner. At length, I was caught at this and then kept at home. My horse was taken from me, the kitchen maid was dismissed, and I became the servant girl. My faith helped me for a little while, even when I was prevented from humming some of my favorite Methodist tunes. And after about a year of this demeaning confinement and efforts by my father and the parish priest to deprogram me, I fell into unbelief and pined away for months and months. I shrank from my habits of Bible reading, prayer, singing, any religious conversation. I became despondent and bedridden and frail. I reached a point of utter despair, and I even considered taking my own life. But then I suddenly realized something. What was I doing to myself? Destroying me. I desperately called upon God against this dreadful temptation and instantly had full victory over it, and the light shone again. The lost sheep that had gone astray and fallen away was found again. I sought forgiveness and my faith in Jesus, and I accepted him again as my Savior. I went into rapturous ecstasy. My family, thinking me on my deathbed, wept for me until I assured them that I was alive and preparing to live. My health began to return with this newly rediscovered peace of mind. And a few weeks later, I became a part of the family again. And my father even allowed me to ride with him again on my favorite horse. When I was well enough to attend church with the family, my father asked me not to go to the Methodist meetings anymore. He even forbade me. I wrestled with this and put it before the Lord. The scripture Matthew 10:17 helped me to decide what I must do. He that loveth father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. When I laid my concerns and thought before my father and appealed for his understanding, his mind was closed. He said he would at once and finally disinherit me if I went to the Methodist meeting again. The next morning, I began a new life, having no choice but to follow the dictates of my heart. I left home in my plain attire that Sunday morning, knowing I would not be coming home that night. At church, I gave my name as a probationer in the Methodist Episcopal Church. I was provided a home with a Methodist family, and soon I had work teaching again. I was eager to learn all about the church and doctrines of the gospel for which I had left my comfortable home. Soon there, I met Joshua Arnold, my future husband, a Bible scholar and teacher, whose head had been converted by the preaching of Bishop Francis Asbury, a prominent early American Methodist, some 4 or 5 years prior to our meeting. We were attracted to each other and married in May of 1799, when he was 29 and I 21. Our 48 years of marriage were truly blessed by God. Our first home in Middletown was built with an upper room, which we called our cottage chapel, so that Methodist small groups called societies and chapel could be held in our home. When we moved to Pittsfield, Massachusetts, a few years later to take up farmland in Lenox, We continue to have rich experiences with our church associations and our growing family. We were blessed with 8 children, 5 sons and 3 daughters, 2 of whom died when infants. So our boys' names were John Wesley Arnold, David, Samuel, Josiah, and Ebenezer Arnold. While in Lenox, God did not want me to be too comfortable, and I was led to minister to a settlement of people outside our valley up on a hill called Washington Mountain. They had no religious ties, so I became the calling ministry, and our ministers would go into call after I had made initial contact. They had no religious ties, so I began this ministry, and I used my writing skills and made house-to-house visits on nice afternoons during the week. God was using me to help introduce these people to the gospel message and blessings, and to help find his lost sheep. When we saw a special need for a school for the neglected children, a private school was established, and I was able to help these people find the other side of town, secure jobs in our valley. It was wonderful to see some of these people come to know the Lord through their associations with our people and the workings of the Holy Spirit. Within a few years, however, many of our people in the valley and from the mountain also felt the emigrating spirit. We decided to move to Volney in Oswego County, New York. We wanted land for our children, and we felt compelled to take the new territory for God. So around 1817, soon after Ebenezer, our youngest, was born, a group of us came to Mount Pleasant area, a virgin territory filled with timber and stone. Joshua and I again built our cottage chapel so meetings could be held in our home. So around 17, soon after Ebenezer, our youngest, was born, a group of us came to Mount Pleasant, a virgin territory filled with timber and stone. Joshua and I again built our cottage chapel so meetings could be held in our home. Each Sunday, after a week of clearing land of timber and stone, we all got together at our home for worship and class meetings. By 1823, our settlement was able to graduate from our log chapel dwelling to a goodly house for our worship service. Reverend Goodwin Stoddard of Mexico Charge consecrated our building at a quarterly meeting when we had the new log chapel built. I could go on and on sharing the rich memories about our experience of the faith in Volney. Let me reflect on just a couple that my son Ebenezer put in the book. Chapter 7 says, quarterly meetings. And that's where Reverend Stoddard consecrated our chapel, our new building, at a quarterly meeting. Our home was host for about 16 years for what we call quarterly conferences. These might be what you call charge conferences today. I remember organizing my home to accommodate all the representatives from a circuit rider's 2 or 3 dozen appointments. They met once a year, usually in the summer, from Saturday morning to Monday morning. I was blessed with a strong constitution and a gift to organize food, and I selected food and accommodations, selecting younger women guests as helpers and waiters so that we would get them fed and be cleaned up in time to make the meetings. I did not want to miss out on any of those prayers, those speakers, or the singing. Mine, we were busy but joyful putting out 50 to 100 meals, 2 or more lunches, and accommodating the families. Men and boys stayed in the barn with fresh hay. The gals and the ladies, the children, stayed in the house on whatever was available. Beds, floor, couches, benches. As time went on, Joshua and I lost these meetings to more central and convenient locations. But those years when we met at our place were special to me. Our ministry changed a bit after the churches centralized in the mid-1830s. It was then the church asked Joshua to go out and visit families and share the message of the gospel. I joined him on these occasions, and it was a privilege to see how people responded to the message he shared about God's salvation and love. Once I remember a young mother asking me about bringing up my children to the faith. I told her it is all of the Lord. I would hold my children up to the Lord continuously. When I fed them, I prayed the Lord to give them bread and water of eternal life. When I changed them, when I laid them down to sleep, picked them up from their slumbers, I prayed for them. When they were old enough, I would sometimes take them with me to my own little prayer room and offer prayers for them. All of our children grew to know Jesus as their Savior. Two of our boys became ministers. David Arnold, in 1848, held the first community foot washing for what became known as the Seventh-day Adventist Church out in Arnold's Barn out in Mount Pleasant. Ebenezer became a Methodist minister in what became known as the Northern New York Conference. Joshua's and my life were long and rich in the experiences of the Lord. I lived some 18 years longer than Joshua, but those years were filled with feasting on the word of the Lord. When I was no longer able to ride my horse or drive my carriage to visit people, I moved into Fulton to live. Each day, the Holy Comforter fed me with a passage of word that my circumstances required. On the last day that I was able to speak, my pastor's wife asked me what had been given to me as my passage for that day. I shared immediately Joshua 1:5 and also Hebrews 13:5. I will never leave thee or forsake thee. Truly God did not forsake me. And when I died in August of 1865 at age 88, I was buried next to Joshua in Mount Etna Cemetery to await further resurrection. To come back today, some 200 years later, and see all the Methodist societies or churches in this area as a result of the labors of those early circuit riders and Methodist societies is truly a blessing. It was a deep privilege to be a part of God's plan, finding the Lord for myself through the saving grace, to have raised my family in the way of the Lord, and to have helped others find the Lord with my husband Joshua. I would like to leave you with the understanding that we all, in our own lives, have been lost sheep. At some time or other, maybe once, maybe twice, maybe more. And the Lord is always reaching out and pulling us back. And once we have found the Lord, we too have the task of helping others who may be lost finding the Lord. God bless you all in your life with the Lord. Yeah.